Again, official welcome to our last webinar series of this year of 2021. And it is my very, very great pleasure and honor to welcome Luana Coloca as our speaker today. And Luana is someone whom we've worked together with on multiple occasions on multiple collaboration projects, and it's always been a great pleasure, and especially within the last year and this year regarding the ZIPS conference, we've exchanged a lot. So I'm very happy that Luana agreed to give a talk today on our last webinar appointment on the topic of placebo effects, and she will give an overview of recent findings in chronic pain patients, amongst other topics, as she told us. So now I will hand over to Livia Azan, who's going to introduce Luana, and then I wish us all a very nice time listening to her talk.
Thanks, Kati, and welcome also from me and Julian Kleine-Borgmann. We are hosting today's webinar, and we are lucky to host this webinar with Luana Coloca. She will talk about recent findings about placebo effects in chronic pain patients. She herself is a medical doctor. She graduated at the School of Medicine in Catanzaro in South Italy. She was then drawn to neuroscience and did a PhD in the University of Turin. There, she also finished a master in bioethics. After a postdoc fellowship at Karolinska Institutet in Stockholm, Sweden, she gained a senior fellowship at NIH, and she then obtained a professorship at the University of Maryland School of Nursing in Baltimore at the Department of Pain and Translational Symptom Science. And since July this year, she is an Empower professor in Baltimore. Noteworthy among many other things is that she directs a clinical and translational pre- and postdoctoral training program. She chairs the special interest group of the IASP named Pain and Placebo, and she is steering member and treasurer for the Society of Interdisciplinary Placebo Research, or short SIPS. And we very much enjoyed the last SIPS conference hosted by her and her team last May. So Luana Coloca, thank you very much for being with us here. We are happy to have you for our webinar series.
Thank you very much for inviting me. And it is a great pleasure to work with you again today in another capacity. And before starting, I would like really to thank all of you for the wonderful collaboration. You were a special partner while we were organizing the SIP meeting here in Baltimore. And we look forward to your meeting in Essen area. So today, I will do a little bit of the tour. Originally, I thought that I will talk about the most recent results in chronic pain patients in our lab. But facing the epidemic of COVID-19, I thought that I should start say something about COVID-19. So the goal will be a little bit to talk about COVID-19, the placebo-nocebo research contribution to this area, and then I will switch to what I had planned and present mostly our recent research on placebo effects explored directly in chronic pain patients. So almost 2 years ago, when we started this pandemic, we were all facing the distress of lockdown our labs, and for some of us was abrupt. In a couple of days, we closed out all our labs. And during that time, some from my team started to say, what can we do? We want to continue research, but also we want to be there present for our patient. And we start a survey where we reach out to chronic pain patients who had temporomandibular pain disorders, fibromyalgia, or some other low back pain, and health participant. And we exclude those who told us that they got the infection. And we focus on the CDC advertise symptoms of COVID-19. And we ask all these participants, do you know if you were infected? If they say yes, we stop the participation there. For those who say no, I had not been infected, we still ask them if they experience any symptoms. So as you can see, about 2 years ago, these were the symptom advertised by CDC. And the goal was to try to understand if there is a sort of nocebo-like report. And as you can see, patient report having experienced COVID-19 symptoms and the same health participant. And the trend was not so different in terms of which kind of symptoms they experienced. Nevertheless, both felt several symptoms that were described by the media. So we thought that somehow there was probably a nocebo effect triggered by media, but we interpret that as a sort of impaired illness behaviors that for those who work in psychiatry, they know what this is. And to full support that, we also ask about the level of anxiety and depression. And we had the baseline pre-COVID and pre-lockdown phase scores for anxiety and depression. And you can see that no matter if they were health participant or chronic pain patient, there was a trend to have higher anxiety and higher depression. And that is not surprising. That was surprising was that chronic pain and pain interference, to what extent their pain interfere with daily life, in temporomandibular disorder participant changed dramatically. They improved. And that was somehow not expected or not anticipated. When we compared the level of chronic pain severity and chronic pain interference during the pre-pandemic and the stay-at-home order, we found that our patient improved for both. And at that point, we also try to understand, and we add what we call the coping strategy survey. So this patient tend to seek more social support, to exercise, to asking for assistance. And probably the push that we had in telemedicine, many physicians start to see their patients through Zoom and other team and so on, that somehow improved their pain. And it has been a sort of lesson that we learn from COVID, and we are continuing now some kind of virtual trials in our lab. Importantly, we felt together with this team, the treatment expectation expert group, that nocebo thoughts and fear were somehow jeopardizing the willingness to be vaccinated. And several people, led by Professor Wim Frederif, sat down together to try to think why this is happening. And I have to say something. The original title had the word nocebo, and most of us who try to publish on nocebo during the COVID received so many rejections that were much more than any trend that we had experienced before. So the editors, when they were seeing nocebo in COVID, they were rejecting by default any paper. So eventually we decided that it was time to change the word, so to talk more about fear of adverse events. But we do know, as placebo and nocebo researcher, that there is a nocebo trend in the sense that there is an amplification of negative thoughts that somehow can trigger what we call nocebo effects. So I suggest all of you to read this position paper that is very insightful and very timely now that we face another wave of this pandemic. And what we did, we started to dive into this, and likely with NDGERS, we were able to start to truly explore the psychosocial factors. And that, again, we had to remove the nocebo in the title, this nocebo term. And we explore by running a survey of people who were not yet vaccinated, and then they received the vaccine. So we start with over 1,500 participants to have then a group of 50-51 participants who actually received one of these three vaccines, Pfizer, Moderna, Johnson & Johnson. And our goal was to compare with what was known in the literature, that age, baseline symptom, having contracted the COVID-19, the brand of the vaccine would have somehow influenced the occurrence of side effects. And these patients were pre-interviewed before the vaccine, and the best predictors of experience side effect and to which extent they felt sick after the vaccine, guess what, was the vaccine side effects expectations. If they expect to feel very sick, they eventually felt very sick. Also, the war about the COVID-19 pandemic was a significant predictor, as well as the depression score. The depression again became something that we observe again and again. Now we are doing another study that actually is under review, where we explore the intention to get the booster. And hopefully this will be out soon, but again, there is also hesitancy in receiving the booster. Another thing that has been a focus in my interest, many of these patients experience fatigue and chronic pain in a way that it has been somehow now a salient topic with several long COVID clinics. At least in our country, we have some in several areas of the states where there is an awareness that this disease is not really limited to the acute phase when people face so many risks, including death, but there is some sequelae and lingering symptoms, in particular chronic fatigue and chronic pain, or this brain fog, that respiratory symptoms and so on, that is creating a problem in the medical community. So we are writing again, well, we wrote already with Calabrese, that is a great collaborator from Cleveland Clinic, and the goal is to try to understand how can we contribute with our knowledge on placebo-nocebo to this topic. And we thought that the patient-clinician interaction here is very, very important, because these patients tend to feel sick months and years after having contracted COVID-19. With this detour that I told you, that I was really interested to tell you what we are doing in terms of studies related to COVID-19, placebo and nocebo. Now I would like to switch to the real topic. So what do we know today about placebo effects and why it's relevant to continue our mechanistic research? And eventually the goal is, how can we improve health and well-being of people who are facing chronic pain? At least this is the main topic of my lab. But as you can see, this can be translated also to the chronic symptoms related to COVID-19. So first, over the last few years, I became more and more interested to try to understand why we have this sort of separation between those of us who study mechanism of placebo effects and those who face placebo responses in the context of clinical trials or a clinical practice. So in general, we talk about placebo effects when we study the mechanism, placebo responses when we study other factors that can be bias, concurrent disease, concurrent treatment, deviation from the mean, Hawthorne effects. So fortunately, in focus on placebo effects, we try to understand the mechanism. And from our research, there is consensus that there are different psychological mechanisms that can trigger placebo effects. We use in our laboratory settings verbal suggestion. This treatment is a strong pain therapeutic, and you will feel less pain. Therapeutic prior experience. For example, we use a lot of conditioning paradigm, from classical condition, partial conditioning, and so on, to create an experience of the master of feeling better and see how health participant and patient can learn from prior experience. We also introduce observation and social learning, because merely observing someone else receiving a treatment that is perceived as beneficial can produce placebo effects, and the ritual, the contextual effects. And finally, the interpersonal interaction, the way we interact with people, and I will show to you some data today. And expectancy is a dynamic concept whereby we know that different psychological mechanisms can create expectations consciously that we can rate, or expectancy, something that we can't even measure, but still is a mechanism that can influence behaviors. In the area of pain, we have been successfully good in advancing our model a little bit, because it's easier to create a model of pain in a laboratory setting than a model of depression. And the reason is clear. I mean, we can study acute pain in milliseconds, minutes, but it's not the same for some other symptoms. And the goal is to try to target the mechanisms, because if we know the mechanism, we can advance this knowledge to the next step. How can we improve our clinical practice, clinical trials, and so on? To do that, we use brain imaging, we use genetic approach, and behavioral psychological approach that are still so relevant when we talk about disparities, or, for example, this kind of worry related to COVID-19, where we don't know the mechanism, but we see a change in behaviors. Then I will focus very shortly on selection of studies that we run in health participants, just to introduce you to our current goal, understanding the mechanism of placebo effects in patients directly. So in laboratory settings, we have been using visual cues. And the reason is because if you do brain imaging, if you do conditioning, it is quite convenient to have stimuli that can be associated to painful stimulations and to pain reports. So the model is quite simple. We use red and green. Then there is a deliver of a stimulus that can be an electrical shock, a laser, a thermal stimulation. We have been using all different models. And then we ask participants to electronically rate their pain. Why electronically? Because it's less biased than asking, how much pain do you feel? Because if that participant like me may say 2 points less, so we don't ask, rather we use electronical scales. And also we don't use, several, for those of you who are interested in methodological aspects, the scale doesn't have several points, but merely anchors, again, to reduce the bias to the max extent. So this model can be used in fMRI, for example, and the goal is to try to understand if prior experience and what we call reinforced expectations, because somehow we force people to believe, in this case, that green-related stimuli are not painful and red pair stimuli were painful. So we do several rounds of conditioning where P stands for pain and no pain, and participants receive the light and placebo manipulation that can be a TENS electrodes or a cream, so that they have this association that the visual cue, the cream, or the electrical sham stimulation is per se analgesic. And after we manipulate their expectation and experience, we do the testing run whereby all the stimuli are set to high level of pain. Then we have a time for a laudable the response to occur and the rating. This is one of the first studies we ran, whereby we show that several run of conditioning produce behaviorally placebo response, you can see here. But importantly, when we studied about the response, despite this participant received the identical laser stimulation, the bolder response is modeled differently because the brain responds as if the green associate stimulations was less painful than the red. Importantly, the activation of the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex can be a predictor of good placebo responses. We can use the identical model with another paradigm whereby we use laser evoked potentials. The advantage is that in this case we can study the response within milliseconds, and an electroencephalography recorded from the cortex show this kind of responses. So the N2P2 change with both verbal suggestion and conditioning, but the conditioning results in a stronger electrophysiological responses. In this case, it was interesting because the verbal suggestion didn't show any behavioral placebo effects, yet at the level of the brain, there was a modulation of the LEP amplitude. Just to reinforce the concept that sometimes we can see in the brain things that we can't necessarily report. That is why we talk about expectancy as a sort of subconscious mechanism as compared to expectations that can be more related to whatever we can verbally report. So expectation becomes so critical when we study placebo effects, and we were wondering, can we violate expectations? So in this case, we use again the visual cue. We introduce a yellow that is a sort of moderate level of pain. The thermometer showed that we tailor 3 levels of pain, heat stimulations here, and we associate anticipatory cue, the colors, and during the stimulation, we show a face that was fearful with high pain, neutral with moderate pain, and happy with low pain. That is the thermos that we use usually. And the goal was to try to see how we can change nocebo and placebo effects when we violate expectations. So in day 2, we moved into the scanner. And what we did, first we set all the thermal stimulation to the same level, 50, and we mismatch the cues with the face. And the goal was to see if mismatching can somehow interfere with the occurrence of a placebo and nocebo effects. So we had 50% of combination in tune with what they learned the day before, and 50% of the association mismatch. So matched cue produce nocebo in red and placebo effects. People who receive the identical level of pain experience higher pain when we show the red, and that is what we call nocebo effects, and lower pain when they saw the green with the happy face. Now that is what we call placebo effect. When we mismatch 50% of the stimulations, you can see that the vast change. So the placebo disappeared completely, the nocebo didn't. These are the individual responses. So at the level of neuronal responses, there was an activation of the left inferior parietal cortex, including the supramarginal gyrus and the angular gyrus. That is an area that is important when we deal with discrepancy and violations. Another line of research that we introduced years ago in 2009 was observation. Can we create strong or moderate placebo effects merely by observing someone else? This was one of the first studies we ran, where we have one of our collaborators receiving no pain at T minus 2. T is the threshold for an electrical stimulation, minus 2. So that was really innocuous. They barely can feel the electrical stimulation, or high level of pain every time the screen was red. We didn't use verbal suggestions. We didn't use conditioning. We asked our observer merely to be there, sit and observe. And after that, the observer was and receiving the same procedure. In this case, as you can see, misleadingly, we set all the pain stimulation at 2T, so twice the pain threshold. These were the results. So they report that every time they receive a stimulus together with the green light that they have seen to be as analgesic in the demonstrator, they perceive less pain. There was no extinction, and the effect was quite robust. That hint us to run another study and see, is this truly? So we changed the sex of the demonstrator. We had a man in the first study, then we use a woman, identical results. So we even compare, you know, social observation with conditioning, no different results, but both larger than verbal suggestions. And then what we did, we use a video or a social observation in person, thinking that maybe the pheromones, the fact that a person is there, can influence that. No, even video was working very well. And some reviewers say maybe are the effects of the color. So we also had just the colors, green and red colors, and this show no effects at all. So merely observing someone else can be very important. And Liven was in the lab together with some another PhD student that now we finish, we were commenting and try to understand why when we observe someone else getting pain relief, there is a strong analgesic effect that is as strong as going through the experience through a conditioning paradigm. And we decided that the best solution was to run a study. So Liv and Skenk spent substantial time in the lab to put together this paradigm and try to understand the change in the brain when we observe someone else conducting or receiving a treatment that is perceived as analgesic, and then we study the people after observing. So one in the lab that was also interested in this paradigm was kind enough to pause several times until we had the most elegant video. And the demonstrator was receiving the thermal painful stimulation with two cream that were colored with food colorant in green or blue. And they learned that one cream was analgesic and one cream was a placebo. Both were placebo creams. And we counterbalance the color to again control for the color effects. During the observation, while our demonstrator showed pain, no pain, based on the cream he was receiving, there was an activation of the temporoparietal junction in both sides, left and right. And you can see that the placebo cream produced a larger activation of these areas. Importantly, participants were differentially activating the left and right amygdala. In fact, you can see that they were much more aroused when they thought that the participant was in pain. And there was also a nice modulation of the periaqueductal gray with higher activation when the participant, the demonstrator, was receiving pain. When we test our observers, we first confirmed that they somehow understood what was going on. And indeed, they produced a different level of expectation for the two creams. So they expect to receive more pain and perceive more pain with the blue cream. And also the level of their anxiety was differently modulated. And importantly, we found that the right dorsolateral prefrontal cortex was differently modulated when they expect a placebo. And it's the same area that I just showed on the conditioning paradigm. What we did, we studied dorsolateral prefrontal cortex, temporoparietal junction, functional connectivity. We explored the functional connectivity during the resting state, before they start everything, and during the task when they were actually observing. And you can see that the functional connectivity can become a strong predictor of placebo effects for both pain intensity and pain unpleasantness. This is the resting state. This is during the observational task. We ran some mediation analysis to prove causality, and you can see that the placebo effects were mediated by this functional connectivity between dorsolateral prefrontal cortex and temporoparietal junction. For the first time, suggesting a mechanism for observationally induced placebo effects. Another goal in the lab is to try to understand the variability, why people differ so much when they somehow are studied for placebo effects. We have now genetic data for a large cohort, but I will show you one of the first studies we ran, and also very unique data on sociodemographic and psychological factors. So first, we started to understand what is known in the literature for genetics. And when we talk about placebo analgesia, three main genes have been targeted: the COMT for dopamine, the OPRM1 for the mu opioids, and the FAN gene for endocannabinoids. So small variants that we call single nucleotide polymorphism in these three main genes have been currently associated to placebo in the context of pain. So we look at these three variants that you can see here, and we explore SNPs, and we want to understand if there is a difference if we use different manipulation like verbal suggestion or conditioning. We were in equilibrium, for those of you who are familiar with genetics, so all the three genes were equally represented in our population. And the goal was to try to understand if we do an interaction analysis, so all the possible combination, if you do the math, for these three variants will be 12 different combinations. And all the graph in transparency are related to those who belong to some set like AA, Val-Val, THR, and these people didn't show any placebo effects. People with other combination, for example, AA, Val-Val, Pro-Pro, show long-lasting placebo effects that were not extinguished. So to some extent, SNPs can help to understand it. This is the most basic approach to genetics. We are now doing much more complex exploration of genetic and omics applied to placebo. But we still want to be very cautious and urge all of us as placebo community to be careful, because when we use the three variations and we add to the analysis the placebo procedure, verbal suggestion versus conditioning, you can see that the ROC curve show that the best predictor come from the combination of the manipulation we use and the SNPs. So the single SNPs per se may vary if we use a verbal suggestion or a conditioning paradigm. So we need to be very careful when we claim that genetic can predict placebo effects. It's much more complex than we may anticipate. And sometimes sociodemographic factors that are much easier to be explored can be very informative. And from here, I would like now to dive into our recent study in chronic pain patients. We use the identical model that you have learned by now, the red-green paradigm, with conditioning, thermal stimulation, sham electrodes here. And the goal was to try to understand, you know, again, whatever we are learning in health participants does translate into clinic patient populations. Well, the story is quite complex. So we study a large set of participants with temporomandibular disorder and much control for age, sex, and race. And the goal was to try to understand placebo analgesic effects. These are delta changes. That means people who experience several times the manipulation that I show, and we average, and here is the CI. So the distribution is quite similar, and the magnitude of placebo effects was not different between TMD and ELF controls. I would like to stress that some people are very high placebo responders with a reduction of 80, that is huge. Some other people are not responders. Those below zero are what we would call nocebo responders. They got worse instead of improving. But the majority of them had a very large placebo effect. When we compare the percentage of responders, we found a significant difference. TMD had 53.4% of responders as compared to ELF controls. And if you are interested, we use a complex modeling for defining a person several times as placebo responder. And it's well described in the paper, but you can contact us if you have questions. BOD, anyway, had a larger proportion of responders in TMD 53.4 versus 67.8. And for those of you who run clinical trials, the magnitude of the response was quite important. In fact, if we compare the number needed to treat of our TMD, it's very similar to what we would achieve with anticonvulsants and opioids. Expectations. So we measure how much they anticipate to benefit from these sham electrodes. And I have to tell you, some participants want to buy these sham electrodes because they felt their pain was also reduced significantly. So both TMD and ELF controls were able to change their level of expectation after the conditioning. So that is very encouraging. We can change patient and participant expectations. And even this is even more important in the TMD population, where we can somehow shift to positive expectation in a larger way as compared to health controls. We can predict placebo analgesic effects with different kinds of modeling. Here we use the latent class analysis that allow us to identify distinct cluster of responses, show that learning patterns are so critical, the extent to which participant, TMD and health control learn from the conditioning was the best predictor for placebo analgesic effects. Also, we are in Baltimore, that is also named the Black City, and we are very fortunate because our lab somehow attracts so many Afro-American Blacks that come to the lab. We had almost, over 40% of Afro-American Black participant, and also our team is diverse. That means some of us are from different racial ethnicity, and that was a very, beautiful setting. I was thinking from day one, this will be a wonderful ecological setting, and I kept inside this thought until, one bright student that was an Empower summer scholar, very young, 19-year-old, come to me and say, Dr. Colloca, I want to study race difference in placebo analgesia. I say, wonderful, let's do that. The data are already here. So the first author is now, he finished all the training, he still collaborates with us. And he was awarded several times for this study. So what we observe is that Afro-American Blacks, the square here in gray, show smaller placebo effects, but not for, all the trials, only the first trial. So overall, we didn't observe such a large race effect. It was very small and not overlasting. So, and this difference was not observed in chronic pain patients and not in controls. Then we thought, let's look at participant experimental concordance. Does this matter? And what we found is when we have the same experimental race as our participant, we have larger placebo effects in our patient cohort. And for those of you who are interested in disparities, this is very relevant. And we didn't see this trend in health controls. In health controls, there was a small trend to have larger placebo effects with opposite sex between experimenter and participant. We are diving into these results a little bit more to try to understand if other races and other questions can be relevant. Another hint was that sex can be relevant. So, also, Elizabeth was another Empower scholar, and we started exploring how sex can influence placebo effects. The literature is quite conflicting. There are different results that we summarize now in a recent review with a postdoc of mine, Ronnie Shafir. So the goal was to try to understand if there is a sex difference in expectations. Women have larger reinforced expectation than men. But eventually, after we run the manipulation, the post-test, the expectations are the same. So, but women seems to be more prone to change expectations than men. When we look at the testing phase, we observe that women had always larger placebo effects than men. What we did, we studied the gonadal phases and the hormones related to women. So we explored progesterone, estrogens, we monitor all their menstrual cycle, we remove those who were in postmenopausal phase, but nothing helped us to understand the sex difference that appeared to be independent from gonadal hormones. The next question that all of us try to ask, do we have a psychological factor that help us to tell who is going to be a responder and who is not going to be a responder? And so Dr. Wang in the lab, prior postdoc, now faculty, ran a very, you know, compelling model where the goal was to try to understand a little more than the single survey. So if we use a larger set of survey, and in particular the research domain of criteria, that it's something that NMH has been proposing several years ago, and here it's known as RDoC. It's a wonderful research framework that helps us to study behaviors and mental disorders. So inspired by this model, we use a large set of surveys to study different aspects of psychological determinant. For those of you who are familiar with you know, some of these acronyms, so we study, for example, neuroticism, empathy, optimism, fear of pain, the reward system, depression, anxiety, positive and negative mood, and so on. So this will show a little bit more in detail, so what we have done. So we use a PCA, and we convert all the 17 battery of surveys that our participants were completing at the baseline as soon as they were coming to the lab. And we identify, based on the ROC model, four domains: emotional distress, reward seeking, pain-related fear and catastrophizing, empathy, and openness. And we model the next analysis based on that four categories to understand how this four domain can be predictor of placebo effects. First, our question was, do our TMD differ from the health controls? And they do. They have, of course, pain-related fear and catastrophizing. They have higher reward seeking. If you are sick, you want to feel better, much more than an health participant receiving a placebo cream. And they are larger in scoring for emotional distress. Empathy, surprisingly, didn't change too much. So the goal was to really use this four domain and try to understand how this four domain can change and help us to predict expectations, conditioning, placebo effects. For expectation, we had the baseline, the reinforced expectation post-conditioning and post-testing. And here is the difference when we add the group. So TMD versus self-controls. So for the reward seeking, there is a difference between TMD and health participant. Patients seek rewards more than health participant. And you can see that the scale show the beta and how they, the direction between this change, fear of pain and catastrophizing become so important for expectation and perceived effectiveness of a treatment, and empathy and openness is a positive predictor. Conditioning, we saw that emotional distress was impairing the ability to learn and retain with a change in acquisition rate independently of the group. And again, independently of the group, we study how these four domains were able to predict placebo effects, extinction rate, how long placebo effects last over time, and the proportion of placebo responders. And you can see that there is a positive correlation link with emotional distress and extinction rate, but also you can see that it's relevant to study emotions when we explore occurrence of placebo effects as well as proportion of responders. And fear of pain and catastrophizing are two big factors modulating both proportion of responders and occurrence of placebo effects. And with that, I'm going to conclude. And I chose this from our review that we wrote with Arthur Barsky. So where are we going as team studying placebo effects? Not just team, I didn't mean only my team that has different idea, different line of research, but in general, as placebo community, what do we need? Well, first we needed to continue to do research with rigor using appropriate control groups, non-intervention arm, assessing expectations, but also to see the next step. So we need to explore more and more molecular and genetic mechanisms to understand placebo and nocebo effect. For this, we would need more animal research that is still missing, more omic studies, large scale. Here I show how much we can do when we work with 800 participants as compared to 18 or 50 or 100. So, and sometimes we don't have all the resources to study large numbers. So then let's sit together and create a consortium where we can share our data to address different questions. And finally, it's important to use more of the modeling. I showed the R-Doc done by Dr. Wang, but there is much more to do in terms of modeling, machine learning approach to understand propensity to create placebo and nocebo effects. And I would like to emphasize that whatever we study in health participants may not translate into a clinical population. So we do need to increase our efforts to study patient and phenotype discoveries. So overall, placebo effects influence behaviors, outcome, and we all agree on that, and depend upon activation of endogenous systems, different neuronal mechanisms. Placebo effects have distinct mechanisms in physiological and pathological conditions, and placebo research is paving the way to tangible knowledge that help us to advance medicine, personalize medicine, and help patients to cope with their pain and symptoms. And I would like to conclude by acknowledging our funding agency, in particular, you know, NIH, and also the TRR Germany that opened the opportunity to do much more together. It has been a wonderful experience over the last 2 years, and we really appreciate that. And finally, here in this photo, we have some of my team. The website is updated, so we needed to create more photos, but it's always difficult to gather together. But my thank you goes to everyone, those in the photo and those who are not depicted in this photo. Thank you very much for your attention. Thanks.